the text. It's a great pleasure to be here. This is a joint work with a number of people, with Marian Bidea, Jorge Gonzalez, Jean-Pierre Marco, Jay, who is already here, and my student Natalia Popka. And the plan of the talk is as follows. So I will say a few slides about computer-assisted proofs, but this is going to be very elementary, a little bit about the ideology behind them. Then I'm going to move to the Arnold Diffusion problem and say what it is about, what interests us in this problem. And I will discuss three methods of attack, let's say, of this problem. The first one is a very classical Melnikov method. The second is very closely associated to the Melnikov method. This is the scattering map theory approach. And the third one, which I think is going to take majority of detail, is connected with an explicit construction based on covering relations on conditions in horizontal disks. And I will say how it applies to a problem, of course, in celestial mechanics, which is what interests us here, which is, in our case, the restricted three-body problem. And maybe before I forget, I have to emphasize that all the proofs that I have done using computer-assisted are based on the CEPD library, and I will say a few more words about it in next slides. Okay, so about computer-assisted proofs. I mean, if somebody has never done a computer-assisted proof, the usual question is, okay, how can a computer prove something? And in my particular point of view, I'm interested in geometric arguments or topological arguments. And a very nice example of a computer-assisted approach is the Bolzano theorem that we all know very well, which says that if we have a continuous function and we know that f of a is smaller than zero, f of b is bigger than zero, then the theorem, the Bolzano theorem, tells us that there exists a point x star somewhere between a and b for which f of x is equal to zero. So what does this have to do with computer-assisted proofs? Well, the main feature here is that we don't really need to know a lot about f. We need to know that it's continuous. We don't really need to know a lot about the actual value of f of a and actual value of f of b. We just need to be able to estimate that they are above and below zero. And then we can apply the theory, a theorem, and obtain the result that we have a zero somewhere inside of this interval. So I think that this nicely demonstrates the ideology, or at least how I see the ideology of how computer-assisted proofs work. You need to have a good mathematical theorem, first of all. So if you want to solve a problem, you need something. This is usually a contraction mapping principle or some geometric argument. In our case, this is the Bolzano theorem. The second thing that you need to do to do a computer-assisted proof is you need to have some numerical insight about the system. You need to know what you want to do, and usually that involves doing non-rigorous simulations or understanding the system numerically. So in this case, we kind of make the numerical tests. Okay, a is smaller than f of a is smaller, f of b is bigger than zero. We know where a and b should be positioned. And at the end of the day, you do the validation of the assumptions of your theorem, and that can be done with the aid of the computer. So the computer in our case is just a machine that checks certain inequalities. Okay, so how does that work from underneath the hood? Well, what computers use is they use interval arithmetic. So instead of using floating point arithmetic, you work on intervals, and you want to ensure that the operations between these intervals, so the result of the operations, include the true result. So every number from this interval plus every number from this interval, their sum has to lie inside of the result. This is the essence of the interval arithmetic. Of course, it has to be encoded. You have to have a computer that can do this. And easy exercise, I mean, addition, multiplication, division, these are very, very simple things for a mathematician to do. I'm not even writing out the formulas. Less trivial are linear algebra and elementary functions. Here you need to do a little bit of work. And for us, I mean, for me, we're doing dynamical systems and celestial mechanics, you need to be able to work with LDEs. So a fantastic feature is that you can, in fact, get a rigorous integrator that will take some initial value and tell you how it's going to evolve through time. So this F that we have here, this can be a result of some Poincaré map on from some section to section, of course, provided that you have a tool that is able to perform all of these tasks. And in fact, well, this is a little bit of an advertisement, so to say, because such a proof, such a tool exists. And this is the CAPD library, that the link is here. And I'm doing a little bit of advertising here. And in fact, if I succeed at highlighting in this talk, pointing the audience, you know, the attention towards this particular paper, I will say that I have succeeded 100% in this talk, because this paper, this is a recent paper by Daniel Wilczak, Tomasz Kapela, Marian Mrozek, and Piotr Spiszczyński, and they have written a paper which demonstrates the capabilities and the features of the CPD library. So this is a paper which has a number of simple examples that you can, with the code on which you can see how the CPD library works. So what is under the hood of these integrators and the library? Well, you can have a look at these two papers. And there is also a lovely book by Warwick Tucker on validated numerics. And in there in particular, you can also see how the rigorous integrators work. But for the purposes of this talk, I'm not going to talk about integrators. For the purposes of this talk, I'm going to use geometric arguments, and I'm going to assume that a rigorous integrator exists. So somebody gives it to me and I can use it. Okay, great. So maybe since this is, I should give a little bit of background in terms of celestial mechanics. And so let me give just four references. And this is a very biased list. So this is a list of some results, just a couple of results, where geometric and topological tools, which I'm going to discuss in more detail in the following slides, have been applied in celestial mechanics. And also this is a very biased list, because it's from people from Krakow. So we have our CPD group, and I just shows four papers. In particular, I think that these two are fantastic papers, and they concern the computer-assisted proof of symbolic dynamics in the Jupiter-Sun circular restricted three-body problem, and they treat the energy level of comet Toterma, and they have a proof of symbolic dynamics. This is one of the earliest papers in celestial mechanics from our group. Great papers. Okay, so, but the topic that I would like to talk about today is Arnold diffusion. And let me introduce the problem here in this slide. So what we're going to deal with is we're going to deal with an autonomous Hamiltonian system, and we're going to keep things low dimensional. So this is 2 degrees of freedom throughout the talk. Of course, the method applies to higher dimensional systems as well, but we want to keep it as low as possible for a talk. And we perform a perturbation. So here we have this autonomous part, we have a non-autonomous part here that depends on time. And I'm assuming that this this time-dependent term here is periodic. And of course we have an ODE that comes from this Hamiltonian. And this is like a trivial observation that since for epsilon equal to zero, we have this this part is autonomous, the Hamiltonian, the value of the Hamiltonian along the solutions of the ODE, they are in fact constant, they don't change. Okay, so here's a short proof. This is just an application of the chain rule and substitution of what is P prime and Q prime. So that's not even spend time on this. But the question for Arnold diffusion that we're asking is, can we prove that for every epsilon bigger than zero up to a certain specific value, there exist trajectories that start with energy equal to zero? So energy, I measure energy by the value of the Hamiltonian of the unperturbed system. So that the energy starts with value equal to zero and we reach one. And this distance from zero to one is the same no matter how small the perturbation. Now, maybe I should emphasize that this problem is not trivial, right? So these perturbations, it's not that you have x prime is equal to zero and then you have x prime is equal to epsilon. So you have something that is positive and that is going to kind of lift you up and the energy is going to increase. We're dealing with Hamiltonian systems. And when you add this perturbation, there are going to be regions that go up in energy and regions that go down in energy. The volume is preserved, so you cannot have a uniform drift up. So the question whether you can actually drift upwards is not a trivial one. It requires some care. Okay, so let me now introduce the particular setting that we're going to work with, and this is going to be in the restricted three body problem. So we work with the restricted three body problem where we have the movement of a massless particle under the influence of two large bodies. And what I'm assuming is I'm going to make a number of assumptions, and these assumptions hold true for this particular problem. So I'm assuming that there exists a family of orbits, and I denote them as these are periodic orbits. So, and this is for the unperturbed system. So this is Li of t. I denote them by L because this is these are, in my case, these are Lyapunov orbits. So we have these periodic orbits that are here. The energy of each orbit is equal to I. These orbits have stable and unstable manifolds, and these manifolds intersect transversely. And by transversely, I mean transversely in the constant energy level. So the system before perturbations is 2 degrees of freedom. So you have four coordinates. If you restrict to a constant level energy, you have in fact three dimensional problem. And this transversality, and let me to draw a different plot. In this particular case, we can see that if we do the plot in a different coordinate system, you in fact see that these stable unstable manifolds intersect transverse. So the question is, of course, let's remember we want to prove that once we switch on the perturbation, that we're going to have an increase in energy. And how can you do it? Well, we're going to exploit Melnikov theory because from such transversal intersections, if you consider different energy levels, you're going to have different homoclinic orbits. You can use that, these orbits. And there is a theory, which is a beautiful theory. I cannot advertise it too much. One can have a look at these two papers. The theory, I mean, I don't want to get into the details because this is like a subject for a separate talk altogether. But the theory says the following, that if you are able to take a homoclinic orbit, so this is a homoclinic orbit to one of your periodic orbits, and you can evaluate a certain integral along this orbit, let's note that this integral is in fact dependent of a certain parameter tau that is in here, right? And by evaluating this integral, you get a certain function. And if you can show that it has non-trivial zeros, then in fact, for sufficiently small epsilon, you will have the macroscopic changes in the energy. And I'm keeping this extremely vague because I don't want to write out complicated formulas, but the formula for this Melnikov function is explicit and it's given in these two papers. So what is important for computer-assisted proofs point of view? For our point of view, the important thing is that you can use computer-assisted tools to get bounds on homoclinic orbits. So I've just listed two papers that do this. I just listed two because I don't have a lot of space in this particular slide. There is a whole library of papers that is concerned with this particular problem: how to obtain the enclosures of homoclinic orbits. So this is a problem that is very well studied. Once you compute the integral along these orbits, you can get diffusion. But this diffusion is a statement for that you get diffusion for a sufficiently small perturbation. Okay, so that's great. Let me talk about the second method that is also very applicable to the study of diffusion using computer assistance. But before I go into the details, I need to define what I mean by scattering maps. So this is a scattering map theory approach. And on this slide, I will define what is a scattering map. So we have our periodic orbit, and I'm drawing a second copy of the same periodic orbit. And I'm assuming, on the previous slides, we know that we have stable, unstable manifolds that intersect transversely. So what I do is I take a single point from the intersection of these two manifolds. So I didn't draw these manifolds here because it would create a bit of a mess in the picture. And then after I choose this point, I choose a point X minus and X plus, which satisfy these two conditions. So the conditions are that if I start from this point and integrate forwards in time, I'm going to start wrapping around this periodic orbit. But this point also moves about, but as these two points move, they approach each other. So this is this lower condition. And if I go backwards in time along the trajectory and this point moves also backwards, then these two trajectories approach each other. And so this leads to the definition of a scattering map. So sigma of X minus is equal to X plus. So the map takes this point and assigns the point here. The definition is a little bit involved because you kind of pass through this single point here, but it is what it is. And we will see why this definition is useful in a second. But before we do that, maybe for the experts, a comment that in fact, what you have is, if you know the theory of normally hyperbolic invariant manifolds, then these two, this is the same orbit, right? But this orbit can be treated as a normally hyperbolic manifold. And then you have the unstable fiber going out from this point. You have the stable fiber going to this point. If these fibers intersect in a transversal way, I'm not going to define precisely what this means, then it means that we have a well-defined scattering map going from X minus to X plus. Okay, so what does this have to do with diffusion? So I'm keeping my previous construction here, right? And the thing that is very useful for diffusion is the following shadowing lemma. So this is a result from the paper by Marian Guidea, Rafael de la Llave, and Teresa Ara. It's a recent paper in Communication on Pure and Applied Mathematics from 2020. It's a fantastically useful result for doing proofs of Arnold diffusion. And it says the following. So let's read what it does. So if you have an orbit of the scattering map, and let me emphasize one thing very strongly. The scattering map is not a physical map. It's, you have this fiber, but you never move along the fiber. The flow doesn't go through the fiber, right? So it's not that you're flowing from here to here. It's an abstract construction. So you have this scattering map that's a little bit abstract. And you take an orbit of this map, but then it turns out that there exists a sequence of times and as an initial point x zero, such that the flow, the true flow, passes very close to this artificial orbit that is produced by the scattering map. So this is a shadowing result for scattering maps. The true trajectory has to pass very close to the trajectory of the scattering map. Now, why is this useful? This is useful for computer-assisted proofs for the following reasons. There are a number of methods in the literature that can be used to obtain explicit bounds on the unstable and stable fibers of periodic orbits or of invariant manifolds. So these things are very constructive. One can study their dependence on epsilon, and you can take your choice. You can use perturbative methods to do this. As a result, what you can do is you can construct explicitly orbits of the scattering map, and you can study their behavior under the perturbation parameter. And if you can show that with each iterate of the scattering map, you increase in energy by a factor of epsilon times c, then the orbit of the scattering map has to increase in energy. Okay, great. But this also means, from the shadowing lemma, that you have a true orbit that increases in energy. So this is a very nice way to prove Arnold diffusion. And there are two papers. They've been submitted to a journal, but they are now in archive that exploit this kind of mechanism. And the second paper in particular deals with the application for the restricted three-body problem. Okay, so I'm talking about tools for proofs of Arnold diffusion. So that's the second one. So the first one was the Melnikov theory, classical theory. Shadowing lemma for scattering map is a second tool that I believe that is very, very well suited. And now we have a third tool, which is an explicit construction. By the way, if what I've been saying here was a little bit too technical and people got lost, this third chapter starts from the beginning. So this is a completely disconnected construction from the one that was discussed previously. So this result is based on the notion of covering relation or correctly aligned windows. So what do I mean by a covering relation? I have two sets, and these sets can be product of some cubes. This is a picture for what this set is in R squared. This is a picture of what this set can be in R3. In the entire talk, the unstable dimension is going to be just one, so these pictures are true. And we say that we have a covering relation between such two sets is when the left and the right sets are mapped to the left and to the right, and the set is stretched so that it passes in a topological way through the set N1. So this is a picture what happens in three dimensions. Yes, so this we have a three-dimensional cube which is correctly aligned, or we have a covering relation for the map F. And if you think, my talk is, I don't have dimension bigger than 4, so we can pretend that this picture is also for R4. The unstable dimension is one dimension, and these coordinates, the other coordinates, they would be three-dimensional cube and not a two-dimensional, right? So this picture is very close to what I want to consider. Okay, so of course this can be formally defined. I'm just drawing pictures, but there's a formal definition, but I don't want to spend too much time on this. Why are these covering relations useful? Well, this is a result that is very similar to this Bolzano theorem, where we had we stretch above, we have one part of the string is above, the other part of the string is below, right? Here, one part of the string is to the left, the other part is to the right. So there has to be a part of the string that remains in the middle. So this is this kind of geometric and topological theorem. And this theorem can be stated, and this is taken from a paper by Marian Gidea and Piotr Stichinski, that if you have a sequence of such covering relations, that there exists a trajectory that passes through these sets. In particular, if you can loop it, so we have a sequence of these covering relations that passes to, that comes back to the set N0, so there's going to be a periodic orbit that travels here. This also is proven in this paper. So correct alignment, this is my version, a higher dimensional version of the Bolzano theorem, and this is one of the components that I will use for my proof of Arnold diffusion. Okay, so whenever I draw pictures that are two dimensional, you can keep in mind that this is three or four dimensional and looks like this. So the I need, unfortunately, three components, so you need to bear with me. So the first one was covering relations, the other is cone conditions. So this is my second component for my construction. And what do I mean by cone condition? Well, what I do is I define a cone. So I have a point x star p star. X is this unstable coordinate that is associated with this direction. P are the remaining coordinates. So I have some point x star p star, and I attach to it a cone. So this is a set of all points such that the difference in x's is bigger than the difference in p's. So this is denoted here as this blue region, right? And we say that f satisfies a cone condition if you have this relation. So you take a cone, you compute its image. So this is f of c of q, right? And that it has to be mapped inside of the cone that is attached as f of q. So this is what it means for a map to satisfy cone conditions. And this is a nice result because it aligns the dynamics. So we have a cone field, in fact, if a map satisfies cone conditions. Okay, so what does it look? I mean, I draw a two-dimensional plot, but you can do a three-dimensional plot. So this would be a three-dimensional cone that is attached at the origin. And the cone condition could be seen as this. You have this cone attached at this point gets mapped to this point, but the image of this cone gets mapped to the cone that is attached at f of q. Okay, so this is what we mean by a map that that satisfies cone conditions. And whenever I draw these pictures, I have these pictures in mind. Okay, so the third component that is needed for my construction for Arnold diffusion is expressed in the language of horizontal disks. And so let's maybe go through this one step by step. I consider a set, which is just the product of intervals. So this is a cube. So my set N is here in blue. I consider a function. So in fact, horizontal disk H is just a function that is identity on the first coordinate. So here is like, this is like an example of this function, right? It's aligned by cones. So I say that I have a horizontal disk if I have a graph that if I take a cone attached at any point, it's going to contain the remainder of the horizontal disk. And why are horizontal disks useful? Well, there is a theorem also from a paper by Piotr Sliczyński, which says the following. The theorem says the following, that if your function satisfies cone conditions and you have a sequence of covering relations, then you have a sequence of horizontal disks. So you start with the horizontal disk H0, which is given. And the theorem ensures that there exists a sequence of horizontal disks such that H0 maps to H1, H1 maps to H2, H2 maps to so forth, and you land with a horizontal disk HK at the end. Okay, so let me make this statement a little bit more precise by actually giving a sketch of the proof. How is this proof done? So you have so I'm going to do the proof for this first part. So I start with a with some set N0, I have the final set N1. I take my cone, my horizontal disk H0 here, and then I compute the image by F of N0, right? What Piotr does, he uses degree theory to justify that the image of this horizontal disk has to become a horizontal disk inside of the set N. So I mean, this picture is a little bit optimistic, because it doesn't follow from covering alone, because essentially you could have this set twisted a little bit, right? It could kind of wriggle around and the sets could exit, but you could have some twists and turns here. But this doesn't happen because you have these cone conditions. So if you assume that your map satisfies cone conditions, the horizontal parts, the cone fields are mapped one into the other. So this means that you're not going to get this bending. So this picture is in fact a true one. And then you just restrict to the fragment that remains here and you iterate the procedure again to another disk and so forth and so forth. So this is like, this is how this theorem works. And these horizontal disks and the propagation of horizontal disks is a key feature that is going to be very helpful for us to construct an explicit mechanism that allows us for the shadowing that leads to the Arnold diffusion effect of increase in energy. And how does this work? Well, now comes the key slide, so to say. So before I state a theorem, let's recall what we had, because I had like a very long intermission by defining the covering relations, cone conditions and disks. So what was it that we were talking about? Well, we had this family of orbits, Li of t. So this is each orbit is, so I focus here in this picture on one orbit. So I have a single periodic orbit here. The energy of this orbit before the perturbation is equal to I. I have the unstable manifold of this orbit. Here it is in red. And it intersects transversely with the stable manifold. So that's a cartoon, what happens here. And this intersection is in a constant energy level. So for epsilon equal to zero, this is a fantastic plot because the system is in fact three-dimensional. But once we switch on the perturbation, we need to be a little bit more careful. So I will introduce coordinates. So the coordinates are as follows. X is the coordinate that is the unstable coordinate at this hyperbolic orbit. Y is the stable coordinate associated with the stable manifold. I have the angle theta, and this angle theta, in my case, this is time in extended phase space. I have the energy, so that's my next coordinate. Sorry, the angle theta is the angle along the, sorry, I've made a mistake. So the angle here is the angle along the periodic orbit, and t is time in extended phase space. And what I can take is the cone conditions and covering relations were expressed in the language of maps. So I'm going to take a map, which is a time shift along the trajectory. And I choose 2π because the restricted three body problem is 2π periodic. Okay, so now if I do this, this periodic orbit becomes an invariant circle. I mean, I'm shifting by 2π. I'm not shifting by the period of the orbit, right? So possibly one point is moved. I mean, possibly, most likely, a point is not mapped to itself, but the orbit, entire orbit, is mapped to itself by my map for epsilon equal to zero. Okay, great. So this is what was the setup from the previous slides way back, but drawn using a simplified cartoon. And now I'm going to state my theorem that leads to Arnold diffusion. Okay, so let's do it step by step. So I'm assuming that there exists some constant which is bigger than zero. And I'm assuming that these maps F epsilon, which are, let's recall, they are shifts along the trajectory, that they satisfy cone conditions. Okay, so that's my first assumption. Then the second assumption comes in steps, and it should be read carefully. So I'm choosing a certain set M that is in the neighborhood of the periodic orbit. And I'm assuming that for every disk inside of the set M, so the disk here would be something that is horizontal along the X coordinate. So this is going to be some graph of some function. There exists a set which I can, inside of which leaves this horizontal disk. So I can capture a horizontal disk inside of a sand, and then I can construct a sequence of coverings. So I'm going to draw a cartoon how the sequence of coverings is going to be constructed. So I take this set, take its image under my map. So it's going to be moved out along the unstable manifold. Then I take another point set and one. So I have to choose it so that I have this topological covering that is needed for my theorems. And then I make a number of iterates and I'm drawing the final step here. And then I cover the set, the bigger one. Yeah? So I'm not covering the set N0 because here I should be kind of squeezed inside of it, but I'm covering the set M. So that's my second assumption. Okay, maybe not the end of it, because I'm also assuming that if I have a trajectory that starts in such set N0, travels through this connection and returns, the energy is increased by a factor of epsilon times C. Okay, and the theorem now says that if I can ensure all these assumptions, then there exists a time, T epsilon, and a point, X epsilon, such that I start with energy equal to zero, and I end up with energy bigger than one. Now, why is this the case? I will draw a careful geometric construction. Why I can ensure this statement? But before I do this, let me make a couple of comments. So I make these assumptions about every horizontal disk. Yes. So the sequence of these sets, they can depend on the choice of the disk. So if I choose the horizontal disk to be closer to the left edge of the set M or the right edge of the set M, I can choose a different set N0. Moreover, the number of steps that I perform can also depend. So the length of this covering can also depend on the choice of this horizontal disk. Another thing that that I need to note here is that with each covering, I'm increasing my disks along the central coordinates. So I need to increase these disks along theta and I. So it's like a little bit of a spoiler. You couldn't continue this indefinitely. So you cannot construct infinite sequence in the way that I'm doing it in this picture. So these are just comments, and maybe the final one, that in fact, how do I check this condition? Well, the way that I do it is I take the composition of the energy with this k iterate for a point that makes this transition, and I compute the derivative with respect to parameter. And in fact, CPD can do this. So this is like a thing that is in fact for free. You take a point, you integrate it in your rigorous integrator computes this, and then you compute the derivative with respect to epsilon. So this is something that the computer explicitly does for. Okay, so let me make one comment. And things that are important sometimes are very simple. And this issue is very important for my shadowing result. And the issue is also extremely simple. So this intermission before my construction is to highlight the key point that allows me to obtain infinite sequences of points that I can shadow. So the statement is as follows. The horizontal grid disks do not grow along central coordinates. For this, I'm making a really trivial example. So I take a linear map, and this linear map is 3 times x. So x is my expanding condition, and 2 times theta. So this central coordinate theta is also expanding, but it's not expanding as sharply as x. So let's see what happens with the horizontal disk under the image of my map. So I take a horizontal disk. So this is a graph. It's inside a cone. Okay, so it gets stretched by a factor of 3, and also stretched by a factor of two in the vertical, in the central coordinate, but in all, it's really stretched. It's kind of make, it's made thinner. So if I enclose it inside of a next set, right? So if I do a topological construction of another window that I need for the next step, the window will grow in the central coordinate, but the disk itself, the part of the disk that, that remains here, will not. And this is a key feature that will allow me to get infinite shadowing. And how I get it, let me show in the next slide. So in the next slide, I will want to make this picture. I will make a true picture in four dimensions, how the infinite construction, infinite time construction is performed. Okay, so here is my shot at a four-dimensional plot. So here I have coordinates x, y. So these are the coordinates where I have the unstable is x, y is the stable one. Here I have the central coordinate, right? So I have like action and angle. I start with this orange thingy here is my set M. And then I take a horizontal disk. So here it looks like this, it's stretched along the x. And here I know that it's not going to be too big. Yes, it has a certain, so it should be like a one-dimensional squiggle here, but I represent, I draw a circle to represent that it's maybe somewhere here. Right? And so how is my sequence of coverings performed? So I compute the image of this set N0, and it gets stretched along the unstable, squashed along the stable. Here, maybe I have some twist. Yeah? So it's moved a little bit along the angle. So I need to choose another set. And so on the hyperbolic coordinates, I choose it, you know, like a standard construction for like a Snell horseshoe, right? And here I just enlarge it a little bit. And again, okay, so this horizontal disk is going to be mapped to a horizontal disk that is here. Then I compute a next iterate, right? So this is stretched along the unstable, squashed along the stable. I need to enclose it, right? Then I have another horizontal disk here. And the interesting thing happens when you return. So I return to my set N, yes? And the thing that is kind of puzzling is I don't really know where the final horizontal disk went. So it went maybe here, maybe it went here, who knows? It went somewhere. So it's contained somewhere inside of this green region. But one of my assumptions was, okay, wherever it went up in energy. So I stands for the action. So it went up in the energy. So it's somewhere, I don't know where, but it went a little bit up. So what I can do, well, let's say that it went back here. So this is a copy of the same picture. So I can repeat this construction again. Because this the size of the horizontal disk did not grow. I don't know where it went, but I know that it went back to the region that I can control. And then I can repeat the same procedure and iterate the construction infinitely many times. Okay, great. So I have about 4 minutes. So is this theorem useful? The answer is yes. So we've applied this construction. So we explicitly constructed these windows for the Neptune Triton system. So this has a concrete mass parameter, concrete eccentricity, and we consider the concrete energy change. So we don't have an energy change from 0 to 1, but we have an energy change by a factor of 10 to the minus 6, which is not huge, but it's not zero, right? And the construction is performed around using a homoclinic orbit to a Lapunov orbit that travels around Triton. And here we have the following theorem, which says that for every epsilon from zero to the true eccentricity, there exists a trajectory such that the change from the initial energy to the final energy is bigger than delta H, where delta H is this parameter. Okay, so this is on archive and soon to appear in the journal. And maybe a couple of comments. We needed to do this explicit construction. So you need to construct, you know, investigate where these sets are positioned, check all these coverings, check all these things. So this is a little bit technical. You have to get your hands dirty and you have to validate all these conditions. But once you do it, you get a number of benefits. And the first benefit is that you can work with physical parameters of the system. Another benefit is that we can treat the whole range of energies. We don't have a statement that says for energy small enough, sorry, eccentricity, perturbation. So for perturbation small enough that we have the diffusion. No, we can say for a whole range of eccentricities of the system, you have diffusion. We have estimates on diffusion time that follow from our construction. I didn't say exactly how that works, but we have explicit estimates, and we have this delta H in our case is macroscopic. So this is about 1 kilometer, and this 1 kilometer distance is covered in time of order 40 years. So this is not such a slow phenomenon as one might think. Okay, so I will be maybe changing, I will be finishing and wrapping up. So what did I talk about? Well, I think that computer-assisted methods are very well suited for Arnold diffusion study, not only in celestial mechanics, but I think also in other problems. The three methods that I discussed first, let's say, are more classical. This is the Melnikov method and the scattering map theory. I think they are applicable. You can get your hands dirty by performing an explicit construction of this form, and you then get a little bit more information. I talked about the application to 2 degrees of freedom, 2.5 degrees of freedom system. The method works in more general setting. It allows us to work with explicit parameters and give a bunch of estimates about time and size of the energy range that you travel. And I didn't talk about this at all, but in the paper, we also prove using the same similar construction, we prove symbolic dynamics in energy. We prove that the sets that have these diffusion effects have a certain Hausdorff dimension. And we also prove that we have stochastic behavior also using this methodology, but this is something that we didn't discuss here at all. Okay, thank you very much for your attention.